boson at CERN, the particle collider. And so what he did is he originally developed these things as silicon strip detectors in the collider halls. So when the particles were flying off, they would use these kinds of things. And he happened to live next door to a neuroscientist when he was working at Stanford, and their kids played together. And they said, well, how does the brain work? I don't know. Why don't you take your device and use it for the brain? And so someone convinced him to do that about 12 or 15 years ago. And so I'm the beneficiary of that. So here's a quick little movie of this device when we have it recording. I'm going to show you 100 milliseconds. So this is 1/10 of a second, and you get spikes on all kinds of electrodes. So you get huge numbers of spikes, lots of data, which is mouth-watering for us. We like that. And we can record for very long durations. So we can get anywhere from 200 to 700 neurons. The electrode spacing is very tight, so we're likely to record from synaptically coupled neurons, neurons that have a physical connection. And the other thing is our temporal resolution is extremely good. It's sub-milliseconds. So we can find definitely when one neuron spikes before another one. That allows us to draw that essential error that I was talking about. The other thing I can say is we record for up to 8 hours. So we can get very large data sets, which allow us to use information theoretic things like transfer entropy on these data. And those typically, those methods, anytime you want to estimate entropy, probably most people here know, you need large amounts of data. So this is a very short section of one of these rasters, and here you can see if we have about 500 neurons, this is what the activity looks like. It's constantly peppered in the background, and you'll have network bursts that are happening like that. So this is the type of data that we get. How do we measure information transfer? Well, we use something called transfer entropy. I won't go too far into the details. I think probably most people know roughly what it is. This is brought up by Thomas Schreiber in a 2000 Physical Review Letters paper. And here's an equation. Brace yourselves. Here we go. All right. I don't know if anyone has a trigger warning for this. I teach undergraduates in a large physics class, and when I put up equations, they tend to recoil a little bit. And this early in the morning, maybe you do too. Okay, so what this is an entropy. It's got the form of a P log P, but the only difference is, as you'll see here, between the numerator and the denominator, in the numerator, you've got this extra term J, and I'll explain what that is. And so if we go to this, here are two spike trains from neuron I and neuron J, and the question is neuron J connected to neuron I? All right, well, what we can do is we can basically say, how well does neuron I predict its own behavior? We can use its past to predict its future. People do this in the stock market all the time, right? So if it's been rising for the past week, you think tomorrow it will rise again. Okay, so we can estimate that, and we can get an information theoretic estimate of that. And now what we ask is, does adding the information from neuron J improve the prediction above and beyond its auto-prediction? So this is not just a delayed mutual information. That would not involve the auto-prediction. So this is slightly different. Transfer entropy has been widely used in many areas of science. Actually, Olaf was the guy who told me to start using it in spike trains. So then I thought, oh, that's fine. And it's been very good. We've tested it against many different methods. It seems to do better than most things. There's a large literature out there on it now. So for many reasons, it's good. One of the things we like best about it is it allows us to quantify the amount of information in bits. And if we're going to quantify computation, spots where information collides, then we'd also want that in bits. So that's the coin of the realm in information. All right, so how well can we do? I'll very briefly tell you something about just generally how well the methods work. We had a paper back in 2011 where what we did is we created a network model of 1,000 neurons. We subsampled 100 of them, and then we applied transfer entropy methods to it. And the upshot of it is that basically, just follow the red box. There's all these different methods of transfer entropy and correlation that we looked at. And what we were able to do is correctly identify about 85% of the synaptic weights in this model. So in the model, we know which neurons are connected to which ones, right? And then we go in and we use transfer entropy to estimate if two neurons have a direct connection. So 85% of the synaptic weights we can get. The strongest synaptic weights are the ones that are easiest to estimate. The ones that are very, very weak are very hard to estimate. But as I'll show in a few minutes, the weak ones typically don't amount to much of the information traffic in the network. So we think the method is relatively good. I could probably talk for hours on how we can improve this and other things. I'm happy to answer questions later about it. But this is at least in a ballpark estimate of how well we can do. Now, how different is this from synaptic connectivity? Just to try to find out if we're on the right track or not. What I'm going to do is show you patch clamp studies and compare that to our information theoretic estimates. Now, in a patch clamp study, what someone does is they take a postdoc and they convince them that they can pay them a lot, and they'll record from 10 neurons at the same time. And they'll put little patch pipettes down. When I was a grad student, patching onto one was like an achievement. These guys patch onto 10 individual neurons, and if you bump the table, you hear screams from inside the room. People are like, no, I lost the neuron. It's very hard to get 10 at a time. But when they do that, they can get estimates of the structural connectivity of which neurons are synaptically connected to which others. And when you do that, all I want to do is say, if you look at the top row, and then you look at the bottom row, things are approximately the same. What they're doing here is they're plotting the number of connections you would expect in a cluster of three cells. Let's take the left panel, upper row left. If you've got three neurons there, you could have zero connections between them, all the way up to six connections between them. And there's two lines. One line is what you would expect by chance, and another is what you would expect, or what you see in the actual data. And what you can see is that when you get to connections five and six, you get a disproportionate number of them in the data, more so than you would expect by chance. And this happens when you go to even larger numbers of cells, like six neurons over in panel D. The above one is from our data in information theoretic measures in cortical slices, and below are patch probe studies. They're qualitatively similar. So when you get to larger numbers of connections, they're overrepresented. Thank you. And this also shows roughly the same pattern. I'll skip over it in the interest of time. So what we find also is a log normal distribution of information flow, which is similar to what people find in terms of the log normal distribution of connection strengths. We also have a log normal distribution of firing rates. These are things that you find in the intact brain in vivo. So this tells us we're on the right track. It seems to be a decent model system. Okay, what do we have? Here's what we find. What's the pattern of information flow in these networks? If we were to take a connectivity matrix using transfer entropy, and we compare it to chance, and we only take those connections that are above chance expectation, we get a matrix that looks something like this. Let me ask a very simple question about it. What if we were just to take a look at the number of connections coming out of a given neuron? So that would be the sum of all the transfer entropy strengths in a row like that. And now what we're going to do is we're going to plot these guys in a plot where they're arranged in descending order of strength. We're going to look at each neuron, the one that has the largest outgoing strength, followed by the next one, and the next one, all the way down to the weakest neuron possible. And we get a graph that looks like this. So on the left-hand side, what you have is the total proportion of outgoing information, and what you have on the bottom is the percentage of neurons that we're looking at. And what you see is that this curve rapidly rises, and then it goes up toward the top. And the main point I want to get across here is that about 20% of the neurons carry about 70% of the information. So this is similar to what people have found in other networks. You don't have a democracy in terms of the neurons. The neurons have the same number of synaptic connections. In that sense, structurally, they're all pretty much equally endowed. But in terms of information flow, a few of them are hogging most of the information flow. This is a really bad thing in terms of social structure, but fortunately, this is not social structure. This is just the brain. It's not a prescription for how we should structure society. I don't want Fox News to get a hold of this and control that stream. I don't know, hopefully they will get it. But it is true that a small percentage are basically in charge of most of what's going on. Okay, and we also took a look at something called the Rich Club Coefficient, and so as you might guess, this gets even worse. The rich neurons tend to talk preferentially to each other more than you'd expect by chance. So there is a rich club of neurons in these cortical networks. And this is the rich club curve that we have right here. This is the pink one that's going up like that. So we get a network that looks roughly like this. This is the sample one. And these colored nodes are the ones that are carrying 70% of the information. They're only 20% of the neurons. Now, what I want to ask finally is what happens when we have collisions of information? Let's say we have a logic gate like this. It's an AND gate. And the inputs and the outputs can assume these different configurations. And what you could do is you could say, how much information can I predict about the output from input A or from input B? And we could basically measure the information independently from input A to C, from input B to C, and then jointly from A and B to C. If I have some kind of computation going on, we'll have synergy of the following sort. The synergy will be that the joint information is greater than the sum of the two independent informations. We can measure that, and we can use something called the partial information lattice that was first used by Williams and Beer in a paper in 2010. So we can reveal synergy or spots where there will be computation in these networks based on this kind of measure, because we're measuring information flow in bits. And when we go in, what we find is something like this. Where does it occur? Think for a minute. Where would you expect it to occur? How many people think it's going to occur mostly at hubs? Any hands? How many people think it's going to occur mostly at poor neurons? Oh, man, you guys aren't responsive. You're like my physics class. Okay, let me show you what happens. N degree does not matter. It is not predictive of where synergy occurs. But places where high out-degree neurons converge, that's where synergy occurs more statistically more often. That's rather interesting, I think. It tells us something. And here's the plot from a paper by Nick Timmy et al. And basically, this curve that's rising here, it shows what I just showed you. I mean, it's basically showing if you have a high out degree, it correlates with the amount of synergy that you have. So, here's what we talked about. What is our question? Can we map with arrows the information flow in these networks? Can we find spots where it collides? We asked it by using high temporal resolution recordings of large numbers of neurons. And our main results are that if we get a network like this, most of the information flow is controlled by a small number of neurons, and the spot where synergy occurs is often in places like this, in places that tend to be collision spots where high-degree neurons collide. And what I'd like to do is thank members of my lab. A lot of this work was done by Nick Timmy, who's in the audience, Sunny Nigam, who is not here, and Masanori Shimono, who will speak later. And also, a lot of this work was done by Sam Faber and Aaron Newman, who's in the audience today. And I'd like to thank our funding agencies. That's it. Thank you.